Vascular access is of utmost importance for our critically ill patients, as we often have medications that need to be administered via IV, large volumes of blood or fluid to give, or even special therapies. In addition to that, in the event of an emergency, we need dependable access for meds. Given that many of these patients are quite sick and receiving multiple meds, as well as certain medications that can't be given via a peripheral IV, we'll often find our patients with central venous catheters or central lines. Alright you guys, welcome back to another video lesson from ICU Advantage. My name is Eddie Watson, and my goal is to give you guys the confidence to succeed in the ICU by making these complex critical care subjects easy to understand. I truly hope that I'm able to do just that, and if I am, I do invite you to subscribe to the channel down below. When you do, make sure you hit that bell icon and select all notifications so you never miss out when I release a new lesson. As always, the notes for this lesson as well as all the previous videos are available exclusively to the YouTube and Patreon members. You can find links to join both of those down in the lesson description below. Also, don't forget to head over to icuadvantage.com or follow that link down in the lesson description to take a quiz on this lesson, test your knowledge while also being entered into a weekly gift card. As well as don't forget that you can help support this channel through the purchase of an ICU Advantage sticker. Again, those are found at the website icuadvantage.com/support, link down in the description. Alright, so getting on with our lesson here, since many of our patients will oftentimes have a central line, it is important to understand them. There are different types of lines for different purposes and some key differences from peripheral IVs. So with all that said, let's start off talking about what a central line is. Essentially, a central line is a catheter that's inserted into a large vein close to the heart, and this is generally going to be either the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava. Now, these catheters can either be a single channel or something we call a lumen, or they can have multiple lumens and potentially have different purposes. And there are three primary sites for insertion. And so the first one is going to be the internal jugular, or the IJ. And this is probably the most common site, as it's quick and easy to get access to with the fewest risks associated with it. And so here, the catheter is inserted into either the right or the left internal jugular vein in the neck, and then the catheter tip terminates in the SVC near the right atrium. Now, if we are inserting it onto the patient's left, then we're generally going to use a slightly longer catheter, as we're going to have to make our way down and over to the SVC. Now, the next insertion site is the subclavian, and this site I actually see used less and less, as it's generally a little bit more difficult to place. It does have some trade-offs with risks, both good and bad, which is something I'm going to talk about shortly here. But this catheter is inserted into either the right or left subclavian vein, and again, the tip comes and terminates in the SVC. Again, if we're inserting on the left here, generally we're going to use a slightly longer catheter. And then the last site is going to be our femoral, and this is our least preferred access site, but it's often the one that we place in an emergency. And so here, if we do place it emergently, it is something that we want to try to get changed out in 24 hours, if that's even possible. Again, we do have trade-offs with risks with this catheter here. And this catheter enters via the femoral vein, and then the tip of the catheter terminates in the IVC. And here we do use a longer catheter for our femoral lines. And so why is it that we use central lines? One of the biggest benefits of a central line is the ease of placement for quick access. So when the necessity exists, it can be placed quickly at the bedside. Another potential benefit of the central line is the ease of access if we have frequent blood draws, although this is something I will talk about here in a minute, but this does increase the amount of times that we're accessing it and serves as a potential risk for infection. But as far as our indications for a central line go, there's really four categories of indications here. The first one is going to be for drugs. So first off, some drugs are irritants to the vessels, or something we call vesicants. And so when we infuse these into smaller veins, this can actually cause issues. By infusing into a large central vein, the medication has a lot more blood to mix with and dilute with when it enters the vasculature. A really good example of this is actually going to be potassium. And here we can actually give higher concentration, so 20 mL equivalents, when we're giving it via a central line. Now, in addition to this, we just have certain medications that must be administered via a central line. And so here, probably the most common are going to be our vasoactive medications, although one caveat to this is going to be that we prefer central line access, but it's not necessarily required, especially when we're in an emergent situation and we don't have a line, but we need to get this medication started quickly. We absolutely will use a peripheral IV, but then we want to work pretty quickly at getting central line access and switching it over there. And then for really sick patients, we often have many infusions that are going on. Now, while we can do this with peripheral lines, those lines are also prone to going bad, infiltrating, etc. And many of the infusions that we have going for these patients are not ones that we want to have suddenly stop infusing. And so having the secured access of a central line gives us that peace of mind knowing that the patient is going to get the delivery of this medication. Now, the next category of indication is going to be for fluids. And here, really, for patients that are receiving large volumes of fluid or blood, that we can actually use large catheters that allow for rapid flow, such as if we need to use a massive transfuser. Another category is going to be for nutrition. So if our patient is unable to tolerate or there's some reason that they can't be given enteral nutrition, that we can give nutrition via IV. And so TPN is what we're going to give when we're giving it via a central line, although we generally do try to avoid TPN at all costs, but sometimes this is a necessity. And then really the last category is going to be our other indications for a central line. So these are going to be things like hemodialysis. So if they need temporary access, we can give them a line that actually gives us faster flow rates to achieve. Some patients also just have poor vascular access, making peripheral IVs next to impossible to get. We also get the benefit of central lines by having some hemodynamic measurements being available to us. And here you can think getting the CVP with a regular central line, as well as other values if we insert a Swan. And then lastly in here would just be for other access that we needed. And here think of your transvenous pacers, again, like I just talked about inserting a Swan or some other cardiac device, etc. As with anything, there are risks and complications associated with a central line. Fortunately, many of these can be mitigated with proper insertion, removal, and care of the line. But the first of these risks I want to talk about is going to be bleeding. And this is going to be especially for patients who have coagulation disorders, but anytime that we're puncturing a vessel and even removing lines, that this potentially gives a site for blood to leave the vasculature, giving us risk for bleeding. This can also come as a result during the insertion if we have a perforation of the vasculature, and this can potentially be a life-threatening situation. Another potential risk is going to be for pneumothorax, hemothorax, or a combination pneumo-hemothorax. And so here, either air, blood, or both can actually end up in the pleural space. And once again, this can potentially be a life-threatening situation. This is a greater complication with the subclavian insertion, and if one of these does develop, this probably means that your patient's also going to end up with a chest tube. Another risk with the central line is going to be misplacement. And the first type of misplacement is actually going to be our arterial cannulation. And this is going to be most common with our IJ insertion and can potentially lead to cannulating the carotid artery instead of the jugular vein. Now, this can also occur with the femoral artery because, again, we've got both the vessels very close to each other there. But in these cases, ultrasound-guided placement really helps to prevent this. We want to make sure, though, that we are evaluating the color of the blood that's aspirated once a line is placed. Although, keep in mind that if we have patients that have a severe hypoxemia, that this may be difficult to assess because oftentimes that blood can look just like venous blood. The gold standard is to get the chest x-ray to confirm placement as well as to check for these other potential complications. And so here I'm going to put up an example just to kind of show you what you're looking for. And so here we have a central line that is inserted properly. As you can see, it comes down to the SVC on the patient's right side. If we had an arterial cannulation, one of the telltale giveaways is which side of the patient you see the line going. And so in this example here, you can actually see the line going across and down on the patient's left side, which would be an indication that it's going in our patient's artery down towards their aorta. And then lastly, we can always just transduce the line if we really aren't sure and we need to get confirmation quickly on this. And so here, if we hook up a pressure line with a transducer and look at the values and the waveform that we get, if we get CVP values and a CVP waveform, we know that we're in the venous system. Whereas if we get arterial numbers and a pressure tracing that looks like it's on an A line, then we know that we are in an artery. And then when also talking about malposition, another potential thing we can see is a retrograde catheter. And this is where the catheter actually ends up going the wrong direction of where we want it to. And this is really going to be most concerning when we're placing an IJ, as the catheter is then running up towards the head. We can also, though, see with subclavian insertion that the catheter migrates up the IJ instead of down the SVC. So another potential risk is going to be with our embolism, and this can be either a thrombus or an air embolism. When it comes to the air embolism, though, this is mainly a complication during either the removal or if a line ends up getting pulled out. This is rare, but it is potentially a life-threatening situation. And I am going to talk more about this in a bit later in this lesson. And then finally, the last risk that I want to talk about is actually one of our most common and concerning complications, and that's going to be infection. So our subclavian line has the least risk for infection, as it's far away from any of our contamination sources. IJ is going to be a higher risk of contamination here because it's going to be closer to those oral and gastric secretions, as well as it's in an area where it's sort of in a nook and it just has the ability to come into contact with more things there. And then our femoral line is actually going to be the highest risk for infection. Generally, this is a dirty area that we try to avoid, and a lot of this has to do with it being close to the perianal area. When we are talking about infection of our central lines, one of the big things that we really focus on, and I'm sure you guys have heard this and had it drilled into your heads, are going to be our CLABSIs, or our central line associated bloodstream infections. Once again, this is potentially life-threatening. And this is almost completely preventable and is usually going to be associated either with the insertion of the line or the care and maintenance that we provide. If the patient has a bacteremia, so a bloodstream infection, with no known or identified cause, but they do have a central line, then we assume that it is the line that caused that. If this happens, we're going to need to have a new line placed. And when we do this, we don't want to be replacing in that same site over a J line. This is something I think that's really gone to the wayside, but I just wanted to mention that as well. Now, when it comes to central lines, we actually have many different types of central lines. A few of these are not ones that I'm necessarily going to be talking about in this lesson, but I do want to mention them here because they are types of central lines. And the first is actually going to be our PICC, which is going to be our peripherally inserted central catheter. And here, this is going to be inserted into the basilic vein, usually in the arm, and then the catheter tip is going to work its way all the way up and terminate in the SVC. These are less prone to infection, but that risk is still present with these. The next type is our tunneled lines, and this more describes the insertion approach to the type of central line that's being placed. And so here the line is actually inserted through the skin and then accesses the vein under the skin. It often has a cuff under the skin to help to hold it in place. And again, these are less risk of an infection, and these are something that are often going to be used for patients that are going to be going home with this line in place. On top of this, we also have our ports, and here this is similar to a tunnel line, except we have the access hub that's implanted under the skin, and then again, tunneled into the vein, and typically these are going to most often be used for patients receiving chemo. Then another type of central line is going to be our hemodialysis lines, or temporary hemodialysis lines. And the benefit here is that these have larger lumens, which equal faster flow. And so here we can see 200 to 300 milliliters a minute or more of flow with these lines. Now these lines typically have a red and blue end, although here both of these are going into a vein. On top of that, you can also have a pigtail access with one of these lines, so something like a trialysis catheter, that in addition to having your two ports for running dialysis or CRRT, you also have an extra line to be able to infuse medication or whatever you might need it for. And so then when we talk about our actual central lines, we kind of have two broad categories. So first we have our general central lines, which are going to be like our single, double, and triple lumen. And here the important takeaway is that the more lumens we have, the smaller those lumens are going to be. And so just to kind of show you this as an example, if we have the same bore, same size of a central line, if it has one lumen, that lumen is going to take up that entire area. If we go into a double lumen here, you can see it splits this volume in half. And then again, if we go into a triple lumen, they typically divide this up with one larger lumen and then two other smaller lumens here. And then the way these lumens work is they typically will have staggered exit points at the tip of the catheter. And on our triple lumen, our distal lumen, so the one that comes out the very end, is typically going to be the largest port that we have. And some of these catheters on some of the lines, the catheter may be compatible with the high power injection. So when we need to have our patient get a CT with contrast, that some of these lines may be compatible with that. And then important to know that, especially with our triple lumen catheters, that the flow rates are often going to be pretty minimal and not effective when it comes to giving large volume resuscitation. Obviously, this kind of varies based on the number of lumens and the size of the catheter. And so if you actually look on the tubing for each lumen, that it's going to list the size in French, which you then can look up and determine what your maximum flow is through there. And this goes for all of our single, double, triple, and even our specialty central line catheters as well. But it is important to know, and if you have the chance, look that up and kind of see, you know, based on the French size of that lumen, how much flow are you going to be able to get? And then especially if you compare that to the flow rates that we like to see with a massive transfuser, you'll see that this is nowhere near adequate. And then sort of our other category when talking about our standard central lines is really going to be our specialty central lines. And this is going to include things like our introducers, sheaths, and our multi-access catheters, or our MACs. And with these catheters, we get the benefit of some larger lumens. And so these can allow for larger flows, especially when it comes to our large volume resuscitation. But they also can potentially allow access for other things, like if our patient needs a transvenous pacer, if we need to introduce a Swan, different cardiac devices, etc. All right, so now let's actually talk about the care of our central lines. There are quite a few things to be aware of when we're caring for a patient that has one of these central lines, so I'll kind of talk through some of these different things here. First is going to be line patency. So at least once a shift that we do want to flush our line and check for blood return. Now, we're not always going to be able to do this depending on what we have infusing through the line, and so do not flush a line that has medication that would be detrimental to the patient, such as a vasopressor. Doing so would essentially be giving them a large bolus of this medication. And so make sure that when you do flush, that you flush with at least 10 milliliters after getting blood return. And when we do this, we want to use the push-pause maneuver. And by doing this, this helps to keep the fibrin clot from forming on the end of the catheter. Now, this fibrin clot can build up and essentially form a flap, which then prevents the aspiration of blood, and really, if left unchecked, can actually lead to an occlusion of that line. Now, if this does happen, whether we aren't able to aspirate blood or especially if the line becomes occluded, then we may need to give a medication like Cathflow to try to break that clot apart and regain patency of that line. And once again, if you do have to give this medication, you can look on each lumen and it will state the volume that it contains, so like 1.1 mLs. And this is going to be the amount of Cathflow that you're going to infuse and instill and dwell into that line. Now, another important thing to know is that we don't want to be using 3 ml syringes when we're giving push doses of medication. And the reason for this is that the pressure that's created by having the smaller plunger can actually be higher than the catheter can withstand and can lead to rupture of that catheter. So we only want to use at least a 5 ml, but preferably a 10 ml flush. Also, we don't want to draw cultures from the central line. If we're suspecting a bloodstream infection, that we do want to use peripheral sticks when getting the blood cultures. And part of our reason for this is we can have colonization of that line without an associated bloodstream infection, which would differentiate CLABSI versus no CLABSI. Generally, if we are suspecting a infection that's originating from our central line, but we don't have the associated bloodstream infection, then at that point, we're either going to want to discontinue the central line and switch to peripheral IVs or possibly place another central line if we're unable to do that. Then kind of the next big area is really going to be with our dressing and site care. And this is really fundamental to preventing infection and CLABSI. And so we want to ensure that the occlusive dressing is clean, dry, and intact. If you have the borders that are coming up on it, that we do want to change that dressing. Now, our standard dressing changes on these are every 7 days or as needed, but keep in mind if you do have gauze that's present under that occlusive dressing, that we do want to change that in 24 hours. Now, this dressing change is going to require sterile gloves and a CHG prep before the new dressing goes down. Make sure that while you're doing this, that you, as well as the patient, if they don't have an advanced airway, are masked. And then make sure that we have the bio patch or the antimicrobial patch is being used and in place. And specifically, make sure that you have the proper size. Our goal is to have the hole that the line goes through that the bio patch touches right up against it. So if you use like a hemodialysis line bio patch, you're going to have a big gap around the central line insertion. So here we want to have the blue side up on this, and the importance of this is that these are impregnated with CHG, and so having that proper tight fit right at the insertion site is going to continually apply that CHG right to the insertion site. Now, kind of going along with this, we also have our line care. So we really want to minimize access to our tubing and the central line itself. Kiros caps, if you guys have them, are great as they sit on top of the open port and really to help to keep them clean when they're not in use. Do remember, though, that if you are going to be accessing this port, you still need to do the 15-second scrub with alcohol or CHG before you access. You do want to make sure that you have needleless pressure caps in place on the end of the line. The primary purpose of these are to help to keep the backflow of blood out of the line and help to keep that line functional. But do remember, though, that we do want to change these pressure caps whenever we're changing our lines as well, which is usually occurring every 72 or 96 hours, so every 3 or 4 days. Now, when a line is not in use, they have the clamp, the slide clamp that's usually on there. You want to make sure and engage that clamp. And this is going to be for the same reason, to prevent that backflow of blood and keep that line functional. And then in general, just be monitoring for signs of an infection and alert the provider if you do see any redness, swelling, purulent drainage, if you note any of that at the insertion site. And so then lastly, real quickly, I just wanted to hit on both the insertion and the removal of our central line. So when it comes to insertion, this is most often going to just be a bedside procedure, and the nurse is going to be assisting the provider that's inserting. Now, some places and some facilities will have nurses or respiratory therapists that are also potentially trained in inserting these lines as well. But some key takeaways when it comes to our insertion: first and foremost, you want to make sure that you are attaching new, clean lines. So you don't want to be using lines that were previously used or attached elsewhere. This insertion is going to be a sterile procedure, so everybody in the room is going to have a cap and mask on. The person that's inserting is going to be fully sterile, so they're going to have the sterile gown on top of that, along with sterile gloves. We're going to be using a CHG prep of a large area around the insertion site, as well as placing a sterile drape over the patient. If your patient is awake, it is important to go over this and let them know this, because they are going to be covered with this drape while this line is being inserted. Now, lidocaine may also be used to help to prep the insertion area. This is often found inside many of the kits, but it is important to know and potentially have this available. You also want to make sure that you do have the ultrasound available, including the sterile probe cover. Also have supplies for your dressing, including your biopatch, although some of our kits also contain everything you need for this as well. And then lastly, when it comes to securement of this new line in place, our preferred securement is going to be with a stat lock device, but these lines can also be sutured in place as well. And then finally, when it comes to removal, really our biggest concern is going to be our air embolus. And again, this is a potentially life-threatening situation. Now, it often presents itself as sudden shortness of breath and coughing in our patient, and if severe, it can actually lead to hypotension and cardiac arrest. If you do suspect that this has happened in your patient, you want to immediately lay that patient on their left side. The reason for this is that, as we know, air floats up, and the hope here is to trap any remaining air in the right atrium. Eventually, it will dissolve out from here. So important to know that when we are removing a central line, that we want to make sure and have the patient lie flat. If the patient is vented, we want to do an inspiratory pause maneuver when we're pulling the line. If the patient is extubated, you want to have them take in a big deep breath and then forcibly exhale through their pursed lips. The goal of this is to create a Valsalva maneuver. The removal of this line should be one steady, fairly quick pull of the line, but you do want to make sure and stop if you meet any resistance with this. Make sure that you are holding pressure with gauze as you are removing the line, and then hold it in place for at least 5 minutes until you've achieved hemostasis. You then want to cover that gauze with an occlusive transparent dressing. All right, and that is going to conclude our lesson here talking about central lines. Covered a lot of different information on this, so I hope that you guys found this information useful. If you did, please leave me a like on the video down below. It really helps YouTube know to show this video to other people out there, as well as leave me a comment down below. I love reading the comments that you guys leave, and I try to respond to as many people as I can. Make sure you subscribe to this channel if you haven't already, and a special shout out to the awesome YouTube and Patreon members out there. The support that you're willing to show me and this channel is truly appreciated, so thank you guys so very much. If you'd be interested in showing additional support for this channel, you can find links to both the YouTube and Patreon membership down below. Head on over there and check out some of the perks that you guys get for doing just that, as well as check out some of the links to other nursing gear, as well as some awesome t-shirt designs I have down there as well. Make sure you guys stay tuned for the next lesson that I release. Otherwise, in the meantime, here's a couple awesome lessons I'm going to link to right here. As always, thank you guys so much for watching. Have a great day.